Good morning.
Morning.
I've just asked him to turn it down. When I took a breath in, I could hear it, and that was not good. How is everybody today?
Well, thank you.
I'm glad that you all are here. My name is Jacob Hunter, and I am the pastor here at Industry United Methodist Church. I welcome you to worship on this beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning. If you were here last week, you heard me say it was Super Bowl Sunday. I'm more excited today because today is Daytona 500 Day. And so, welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. I invite you to join me in an attitude of prayer as we begin worship this morning with our opening prayer. Let us pray. God of the mountaintop and the plain, we remember today the transfiguration of Jesus. Glorious, mysterious, and shimmering with light, you know our hearts, our triumphs, and our disasters. Take us as we are. Love us as we are. Join with us and transform us into your holy ones. Amen.
Would you stand with us as you're able?
Up this morning with my mind set on Jesus.
Woke up this morning with my mind set on Jesus.
Woke up this morning with my mind
set on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Walking and talking with my mind
set on Jesus.
Walking and talking with my mind
set on Jesus.
Walking and talking with my mind
set on Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praying and singing.
Woke up this morning with my mind set on Jesus.
Woke up this morning with my mind set on Jesus.
Woke up this morning with my mind
set on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 One more time. One more time.
Hallelujah.
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 When the Spirit of the Lord moves in this place, I can dance like David does. When the Spirit of the Lord moves in,
Spirit of the Lord moves in this place. I can praise Him all day long.
When the Spirit of the Lord moves in this place, I can praise Him all day long.
You to join me in an attitude of prayer for our prayer of illumination. Let us pray. O Lord, on this Sunday of Transfiguration, we pray that your light would pour over these pages and illumine these old, old words. We pray that they would dance with newness in our hearts and minds, that we would be radiant in reflecting your word in our living and serving one another. Amen. Our first scripture reading today comes from the Old Testament, from the book of Exodus, Exodus 24, 12 through 18. Listen for the word of God. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there. I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Look, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has the dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the Israelites. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights.
Would you stand with us as you're able?
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget your love for me again. My heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end.
my feet and a light unto my path. And a light unto my path.
All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you. I invite you to remain standing as you are able for our gospel reading today. Our gospel reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Once again, hear the word of God. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became bright as light. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will set up 3 tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they raised their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Y'all may be seated except for the young folks. Well, good morning, guys. How are y'all today?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. Y'all, anyone have any cool socks? Because I've got really cool socks today. Yeah. You have long socks, white socks. Oh, what are yours? They're like a doggy? Dogs make me happy. Well, that's absolutely true. You ready to see mine? You have white socks? Here are mine. Macaroni and cheese. How can you get any better than macaroni and cheese? Yeah. Macaroni and cheese makes me happy, just like dogs make you happy. So today's passage, today we're celebrating something. Do you know what today is? What we're celebrating today? No, it's okay if you don't. It's not a big day, and I'm going to talk about it in a little bit. We are celebrating Jesus today. That is absolutely right, because it's always the answer, right? Today we're celebrating what's called the Transfiguration. Do you know what that means? Y'all have let's work through it. You know, so like think about, the only thing that comes to my mind when I think about this is Transformers. Y'all know what the Transformers are, right? No? You don't know what Transformers are? How's that even possible?
Good upright.
It's a car that turns into a robot? Okay, but you know what they are. Okay, so Transformers, right? They're these cool cars, or my favorite one, Optimus Prime, right? He's a big 18-wheeler.
He's not.
And he's a toy, right? I should have brought. Okay, I should have brought my toy. I have a Optimus Prime. Anyway, what happens with the Transformers? They're a car or a truck, and they're going down the road, and then something happens, and what happens? They change, and they're a robot. If y'all aren't with me, it's this really cool thing, these robots that turn into cars. Anyway, so they transform, right? And they become something else, and they look completely different. But really, they're the same thing. They don't change, right? They have all the same parts. They just become something else. That's kind of what happens here with Jesus. He goes up the mountain with a couple of the disciples, right? With Peter, James, and John. And they go up the mountain. And they leave the other disciples down at the bottom. And as they're up on the mountain, all of a sudden there's a bright light. And the disciples look, and it's Jesus. He's glowing white. He's so bright. It looks like his clothes are lit up, like they're light. They're just so bright and shiny, like a shininess that the disciples have never seen. His face is glowing. And he's become this other thing, but he's still Jesus. And he looks completely different, but exactly the same. If that makes sense. It doesn't. You're right. You're absolutely right. But he's the same person. He just is now this like glowing brightness, bright light.
It's like,
Sure, that's absolutely right. We are the same person with different clothes on. You're absolutely right. And so that's what happens to Jesus, and the disciples are shocked. As I imagine any of us, if we saw a transformer in real life, we'd be shocked, would we not? And so that's what's happening with the disciples. They're shocked. They don't know what to say. They don't know what to do because they're seeing this for the first time. And then they get scared. And then God's voice comes booming down from the sky, and they put their faces down on the ground. And then the next thing that happens, Jesus comes up to them. And he puts his hand on their shoulder, and he says, guys, it's okay. Get up. Don't be afraid. And he's normal again. He's the way they had seen him right before all of this. But during this time where he was transfigured, and we celebrate Transfiguration Sunday today, he's talking with Moses and Elijah. And there's these amazing things happening. And it's showing the disciples of what's to come. And what's going to come, we're going to be talking about starting next week. Because we enter into Lent next week. Well, this Wednesday, actually. So we're going to be talking about all of this. We're going to be talking about Palm Sunday and all sorts of stuff like that. But just remember, if you hear Transfiguration and you hear that, just think about Transformers. I think that's the best way to think about it. Okay? All right. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the gift of your Son, and thank you for his mighty acts. Thank you for speaking truth to the disciples when you spoke those words. This is my Son. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. Help us, each and every one of us, every day to listen to you. Lord, I ask you to be with these young folks and their families as they leave this place. Watch over them and guide and direct their lives. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So today is the final Sunday of the season of Epiphany. You see, we have Advent. And as we go through Advent, then we get to Christmas. And then we're in the season of Christmas for a couple of weeks. And then we celebrate Epiphany. And then we go through the season of Epiphany. And we're just about to finish Epiphany. Today's our last day. On Wednesday, we'll have Ash Wednesday, which is the beginning of Lent. Sometimes people make lists of things they're going to give up during Lent. I don't know, have any of y'all even thought about it yet? Or are you like me, if you're going to do it, wait till Wednesday morning to do that and just figure. As we get closer to Lent and to this season of Lent, where we take time to slow down, just like we do in Advent, but we slow down and we start to think about and we start to work our way towards Jerusalem and to the cross. And we start to think about Holy Week. There are so many things going on. I just want us to remember as we enter into Lent the importance of it. And so until we get there, we're still celebrating Epiphany. And today, that is exactly what we're going to do. We're closing Epiphany the way we always do with Transfiguration Sunday, in which we talk about the Transfiguration, and we remember that, and we celebrate it. It's a story that's in all three of the Synoptic Gospels. We get three versions of the Transfiguration. And it's an amazing thing. It's a great story, because one of the things it does is it illustrates something we talked about last week. Do you remember what we talked about last week? It's okay. I actually spoke twice, and I had to go look at my notes. Last week, we talked about being the light of the world, didn't we? We talked about Jesus coming as the light of the world. And what better illustration of Jesus being the light of the world than the Transfiguration, where he starts glowing and his clothes are bright and shiny? There's no better way, in my mind, to think about being the light of the world than the Transfiguration story. So as we start to talk about the Transfiguration story, there's a couple of things that are very interesting. One of them is the passage begins, like some do, just telling us something that isn't a complete thought. Because it says, 6 days later, Jesus took with him. 6 days later. We've missed what happened. We don't know where we're coming from. We just know that 6 days ago, something happened. Well, what happened 6 days ago? 6 days ago in the Bible, in the story, in the book of Matthew, we have come from Caesarea Philippi. Jesus and the disciples were at Caesarea Philippi. They were having this special moment, and there's this conversation that's happening, and Jesus asks the disciples, who do the people say the Son of Man is? Who do the people say that the Son of Man is? And they're all sitting there, and the disciples start answering. And the answers are kind of just all over the place, kind of like a shotgun, just everywhere. Someone's like, some say you're John the Baptist, which is kind of weird because they were alive at the same time. Some say Jeremiah, and some say Elijah, and some say one of the prophets. So we have all of these possible answers for when Jesus asks the disciples, who do the people say that I am? This is what the people are thinking. And one of them is Elijah. We're going to get back to Elijah in just a bit. So he gets those answers from the disciples, and then he looks at them and he says, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? And here we go. This is Simon's moment, right? This is Simon's big moment. And he looks and he speaks up and he says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. I can just imagine the other disciples like, oh, Simon got one right. At that very moment, Jesus then tells Simon, you are no longer Simon, you are now Peter. And on this rock, I will build my church. You are Peter. And on this rock, I will build my church. I know some of you know this, but some of you don't. The word Peter, in the original Greek, is Petros. Petros. Which literally translates rock. Or the rock. Not the cool action star who was a wrestler. An actual rock. So now Peter, now Simon has become Peter. There's been this moment. Jesus has had this conversation about who he is. He's finally revealed to the disciples who he is. Now they are all sure. Because before that, they are still wondering. They're still guessing, some of them. And they've had this moment. And then what happens? Very much like what Peter normally does, he then says something very dumb. Immediately following that exchange is the famous exchange where Jesus is telling the disciples that he has to die at the hands of the chief priests and the elder. And Peter speaks up, and what does he say? God forbid it. This must never happen to you. And Jesus quickly looks at him and responds, get behind me, Satan. He was just called the rock that the church was going to be built on, and now he's being called Satan. There's a really good sermon there, and someday, in the near future, we're going to have one, I promise. But see, all of this is what happened 6 days before the transfiguration. And then we don't get the story. We don't know, other than they're on a mountain now. They've been at Caesarea Philippi, which is up in the Golan Heights, up in the northern part of Israel. They've been up there, and it's this kind of horrible place for them. It's a very, very pagan city, and they've had this moment, and they've realized that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And now, 6 days later, they're on a mountain. They've traveled there. And on this mountain, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up with him. And they go up the mountain, and the other disciples stay down at the bottom. And then the transfiguration happens. There are two points I'd like to make about today's passage before we go too much further. The first one is that this passage is very similar to the passage we read from Exodus. In the passage from Exodus, Moses is there on the mountain with the people, and he and a few of his people go up the mountain, and then he goes a little bit further, and then the mountain lights up, and there's this cloud, and it says it's a bright, shining light. Moses and Jesus were both shining after their encounter with God on this mountain, on their mountain. And I think it's also important for Elijah to be with Moses and speaking to Jesus. I think it's important for several reasons, but one of the most important is because people think Jesus is Elijah. And so maybe in the disciples' mind, even though he has said, they have said, you are the true Son of God, the Messiah, maybe that some of them are still wondering, could it be Elijah though? And so now they know that it's not Moses. And Jesus is now there, and three of the disciples are with him during this moment, and they can see him talking to Moses and Elijah, which proves to them, and then they are able to tell others that he is indeed not Elijah, because Elijah was with him during the transfiguration. That's an important thing. It helps prove that he's not Elijah. Another thing, as all of this is happening, as everything is happening, as Jesus is bright and shining and they're trying to figure out what's happening, and all of this is going on, and can you imagine the amazement of the disciples when they're sitting there, standing there, and then in front of them, not only Jesus, but Moses and Elijah, and all of this is happening at once. What happens? Who's the first person to speak up once again? Peter. Absolutely. Peter. And he says, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He wants to make little huts for them, little altars, something for them to remember where it happened. A place where they can come back to. And for years, theologians, pastors, people, Sunday school teachers, everyone has said how fast Peter was to speak and how incorrect, how it was just, he just blurted something out because he was in this moment and didn't know what to do. And they basically have said for years and years that he was wrong, and why would he even want to do that? I half agree with that. Yes, he did blurt out probably the first thing that came to his mind. Well, maybe not the first thing, but one of the first things that came to his mind as he's watching this amazing thing take place. And the first thing is, let us build three little huts for you. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. The first reason I would say that I only half agree is he's wanting to be part of it. He's wanting to do something. He's not just sitting there passively watching. He's not just waiting for someone to tell him what to do. Peter does at least want to take action and do something. And what he wants to do is build little huts. And in these little huts, he wants to be able to remember and tell this story about Moses and Elijah and Jesus having this moment. And it's a beautiful thing. And he's wanting to do. He's wanting to do something and not just sit there and be a spectator. He wants people to know and remember what happened. But you see, I think the reason he gets it wrong, I think the reason that he gets it wrong and Jesus tells him before really anything happens, basically he wants to do something so it's remembered. And what's really happening, at least I believe, is that Peter wants to confine this story to those huts on the Mount of Transfiguration. He wants for it to be a place there. And I think Jesus' vision, I think God's vision, is much larger than just that little spot right there on the Mount of Transfiguration. Now, I will tell you, if you go to one of the two Mounts of Transfiguration in Israel, you're going to find the spot where the tour guides are going to tell you, this right here is where Jesus started glowing, and this is where Elijah stood. the tourist people got it. They got this story, and they were like, we're going to do that. They didn't understand. What Jesus and what God is doing is so much bigger than a little hut on the side of a mountain in the Holy Land. Showing that Jesus truly is the Son of God, can do these amazing things, is so much bigger than three little shacks on the side of a mountain in Israel. Peter, in my mind, while I don't think he was exactly right, he at least deserves an A for effort. He wanted to do something. He wanted to be sure that that story was told and there was a way to tell it and maybe even a way to point directly at it. He deserves credit. But his vision still at this point is not as big as God's and as Jesus's. Ultimately, we're going to get the story. We're going to get the story. Now, as we get to the end of the passage, the end of the story, Peter is speaking and talking about these huts and wanting to build them and one for Elijah. And as he's speaking, what happens? God interrupts him. This booming voice comes to them on the mountain and says, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." And at that point, the disciples all fall to the ground in fear. They don't know what to do. Imagine, put yourself in their shoes. You're watching Jesus, your friend, glowing white. And then these two glowing figures next to him, who you know are Elijah and Moses, some of the people you look up most to from the stories in the gospel, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, you're seeing them having this conversation. You don't know what to do. You start just kind of rambling about a hut. And then God's voice booms down and says, "This is my son, the beloved." Just, how do you even process all of that? So it makes sense that they finally just fall to the ground. They fall to the ground. They've overloaded. They don't know what to do. They're on the ground. And the next thing that happens, as they're laying there on the ground, Jesus walks up and touches them. I imagine he like puts his hand on their back or on their shoulder, and he says to them, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of everything that just happened. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of the voice of God. Don't be afraid. No, it's going to be okay." Jesus is now comforting them. He's comforting them as they have gone through this experience. Jesus knows that this experience is an important part of the passion. It's an important part that the disciples had to see this happen after they had a hard time believing him that he would be killed at the hands of the chief priests and elders. Jesus had just told them, "I'm going to be killed by the chiefs and the chief priests and the elders of the synagogue." Peter couldn't believe it, said, "That can't happen." All of this is leading up to Holy Week. He's got to get the message to them. And so this experience that they had, this experience like no other, was a way for them to see the true power of God at work, the true miracle of God at work. Because when Easter Sunday comes, and then the days following it, where Jesus does appear to them as the resurrected Lord, as the resurrected Jesus, they're going to have that same faith that they had during this experience to know that things like this can happen. Because if they hadn't had these moments, if they hadn't had this happen to him, it's possible that they would be like, "Well, maybe this isn't really happening." but they've seen the power of God at work. It helps them. They have this amazing experience. The last thing that happens, they've gone through all of this together. They're coming back down the mountain. Jesus, James, John, and Peter, they're coming down the mountain. Imagine how excited they probably are. They want to run down and tell the other disciples, at least, I'm sure, y'all are not going to believe what just happened. Can't you just see running? Oh my God, Elijah and Moses and Jesus was like a glowing orb, and I can just see it. And Jesus knew that it wasn't time yet. So he says to them, he instructs them to not say a word until after his resurrection. I don't know about you, but these disciples must have been really good secret keepers. I would trust them on any SPRC board if they can keep a secret like the Transfiguration. But it was an important experience because after the resurrection, they're going to be able to tell everyone, you guys, this also happened to us. This is not something you're imagining. This risen person that's before us is Jesus. We saw him talking to Elijah and Moses. And it helps the story. And it helps the disbelief. When the disciples are struggling to believe and understand, it helps them to understand better. It helps them to have that belief that Jesus truly is resurrected and standing there in front of them. So why do we celebrate Transfiguration Sunday? Why is it an important day in the church and in our lives? Well, the UMC Discipleship website says this. I read this every year because I think it's important for us to know why we are celebrating Transfiguration Sunday. We celebrate the revelation of God, of Christ's glory before the Passion, so that we may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness. The focus of the Lenten season is renewed discipline in walking in the way of the cross and rediscovery of the baptismal renunciation of evil and sin, and our daily adherence to Christ. We celebrate this to help us get in the right mindset as we move into Lent. As we move into Lent, there's all of these things going to happen. We're going to be telling the stories like we tell. The story, we're going to go to Holy Week, the Passion of Christ, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. We will get to all of that. But I truly believe it's important as we get to that to help get us in the right mindset by celebrating the Transfiguration. This moment where Jesus reveals to the disciples who he truly is. And as we talk about it, the one thing I will tell you is, please do not wait until after the resurrection to tell people about God and these amazing things that are happening. Go out and share it. My prayer for you and myself this day is that this season of Lent, you can take strength. You can take strength in the celebration and the preparation for Easter. After our celebration of the revelation of Christ's glory on the mountaintop during the Transfiguration. Amen. Is the Apostles' Creed not on the slides back there? It's okay. We'll move on. We'll start with prayer requests. We now come to that time in our worship service in which we take a moment and we pause and we share with one another the joys and concerns that are on our hearts and minds. And then with one voice, we lift those joys and concerns to God. This morning, I'll begin with our concerns and then I'll move into our joys. We start with our concerns, and we lift up all of those who are sick, all of those who are ill, all of those who are needing recovery or healing. We lift up and pray for them. We pray that God places his healing, loving hand on them, and that God reminds each and every one of them that he is with them. We lift up and pray for our leaders around the world. As we do so, we pray that as they seek to make decisions for the people they serve, that they do so not for their own interest or the interest of a select few, but that they do so for the betterment of all the people they serve. We lift up and pray for the people of Ukraine as they continue to suffer. We pray for them, especially that this week marks 1 year of this horrible atrocity that's happening to them. We pray and lift up those people in Ukraine. We lift up prayers of peace for the Holy Land and for the Middle East, and we just pray that this thing that seems impossible might come true someday, and hopefully sooner rather than later. We continue to lift up much-needed prayers for the people of Turkey and Syria. I also lift up prayers for our congregation as we move through the process of discernment. I lift up prayers as we do that. We also lift up prayers for President Jimmy Carter and his family as he has begun home hospice care. I also lift up, earlier this week, a shooting in Michigan State University in which 3 students were killed and 5 others wounded. We pray for all of the people affected by gun violence. A couple of joys that I would like to share with you. This is a very selfish one, and sometimes I do that. But this past Tuesday was pitchers and catchers reporting to spring training, which means baseball's right around the corner. And I'm excited. I also want to lift up a joy of celebrating. Yesterday, Leona Ludeker celebrated her 98th birthday.
Wow.
And so we celebrate that. Also from Terry, a praise. Diane Blanks, who is the daughter-in-law of Freddie June and Bill Blanks, had one bypass on Friday and is up and walking and doing great. And so we celebrate the quick recovery so far, and we can pray for continued recovery and healing. Those are the joys and concerns that we have this day. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, you are the mighty one. You created light. You send your light around the world. You sent your Son into the world of darkness as the one true light, the light that brings hope to all. And yet, we want to capture it like a firefly and keep it to ourselves so that we have that good feeling and experience. At the same time, there are those who would reject your light. Try to find any way imaginable to cover your light. But God, you told us to be the light of the world and to let our light shine. And so today, as we pray, we want to let our light shine for others whose light may have grown dim or has almost gone out, or even some that are in the dark. We want to shine the light of hope to those who are discouraged, dejected, and disappointed. We want to shine your light of love to those who are our enemies, who are hated, are bullies, abused, bullied, and disenfranchised. We want to shine your light of grace to those who have given up, don't believe God loves them and don't feel wanted, but are lonely and needy. We want to shine your light of faith for those who are hungry to believe, yet are not sure, those who have struggled a long time with chronic illness, frustration, anger, and disbelief. Lord, we carry your light into this world for all to see what a glorious and wonderful God you are. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we prepare for this morning's offering, I want to make an announcement about the offering this morning. If you were here last week, you heard me say, after we lifted prayers for the people of Turkey and Syria, that this week we would be taking a special offering that's going to go to UMCOR, and that offering will be given to UMCOR to go directly to help the people of Syria and Turkey. I would ask that if you want to donate to the people of Syria and Turkey, and to UMCOR, that you would either put your offering in one of our envelopes, which are on the back table, and then write on it somewhere, offering for UMCOR. Or if you're going to write a check, you can just put the check in the offering plate, but in the memo, please put offering for UMCOR or put UMCOR or something like that, so we know that that is money designated to go to UMCOR. I want to just give us an opportunity as a congregation to, in whatever little way we can, help the people of Turkey and Syria as they begin to process and rebuild and try to just go about their lives again after this horrible event. So that is what I would ask of you. I would also let you know that we won't send that offering like tomorrow, so if you don't have the ability or today but you still want to, you can still get it to us, and we'll probably do this again one more Sunday so you have that opportunity one more time. As we prepare for the morning's offering, is there somebody who would like to come take our offering? I've only got one plate. I don't know where the other ones are, so I'm sorry. Let us pray. God of power and love, we come to worship this day in anticipation, to hear music, to be fed with the word, to reconnect with our church family, but most of all, to listen to your voice as it might speak to us in silent moments. May your goodness and caring be affirmed in the gifts we give. And as worship comes to an end, may we hear Jesus' voice sending us out into the mission field. And may we listen and go. Amen.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Teach me to love you. Teach me to pray that Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
As our time of worship comes to an end this morning, I would make the invitation before our final song, an invitation that if you are not a member of this body of Christ, if you have not become a part of our family and wish to do so and become a member, I would invite you to come up during the singing of this song or come talk to me about membership. Please stand with us as you're able.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing.
Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God,
standing on the promises I cannot fail. Through hell and storms of doubt and fear have sailed, by the living word of God I shall prevail.
Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God,
standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, and eternally my lunch don't pour, overcome and ready with the Spirit's sword.
When y'all hold that breath that long.
As we prepare to go out into the world this day, a couple of short announcements. The first is, don't forget, we've started season 2 of The Chosen. We'll meet here in the Fellowship Hall at 4:30 again today. We'll watch the next episode of The Chosen and have a discussion afterwards about it. Also, coming up on Wednesday morning, we're going to do drive-through ashes on this, being the circle drive in front of the church from 6:45 to 7:30-ish. We'll be out there if you want to come get ashes in the morning before you go to work, or if you're just up early and want to come get ashes to start your day on Ash Wednesday, come over and see us, and we'd be happy to do that. Wednesday night, we have a service at 7 p.m. in the historic church. It's our Ash Wednesday service with the imposition of ashes, so we will be doing that in the historic church on Wednesday evening at 7. And our Bible study starts next week, not this week, but next week, February 28th and March 1st, Tuesday night at 6 p.m. on Zoom, and then 10 o'clock on Wednesday morning here in the Fellowship Hall. We'll be doing our Bible study, which is this book, Entering the Passion of Jesus. So we'll be doing this. There's one other short announcement with this. I want you to know that I'm going to be doing a sermon series on this book during, during Lent, this Lent. And so, if you want to hear the Palm Sunday story, come next week. I'm not going to be preaching that passage on Palm Sunday because it starts with Palm Sunday and it goes through each day of Holy Week. So as we go through the study and the series, we'll be going through each day of Holy Week, and we're going to start with Palm Sunday. So we're actually going to kick off Lent with Palm Sunday this year. So I invite you to come for that. The final announcement I have is I have the chicken. If you want to donate to the hospice luncheon chicken, I have the chicken. I'm going to leave it up on the altar. You can make your donation there. I've been asked to make that announcement. So here's the chicken. Those are the announcements that I have. As we go out into the world this day, and as you leave this place, may the living Lord go with you. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, beneath you to lift you from your sorrows, within you to give you the gifts of faith, hope, and love, and most importantly, always before you to show you the way. Amen.
Amen. Standing on the promise of Christ.